A very good afternoon to all of you gentlemen and ladies, of course. It's a pleasure, a privilege, I would say an honor, being at Help Talks at the Help Library. And the topic that I will share my thoughts with you today, that the power resides within us, exists within us, is manifested within us. The belief is firm that each one of us was born for success, was created for success, and was made for success. It is only a question of utilization. And the next 1 hour we will discuss ways on which, by means of which, we can utilize these latent powers which manifest within us and unleash them so that we can achieve our goal of becoming the greatest. When I say the greatest, I am reminded of the man who called himself the greatest. His punchline, his tagline, his identity line was, "I am the greatest." Yes, sir, anybody on who he was, "I am the greatest," said he. Absolutely right, sir, Muhammad Ali. Sportsman of the century, some call him sportsman of the millennium, of the last 1,000 years. Goes down in history as the only man to have won the World Heavyweight Boxing Championship, not once, not twice, but 3 times. Third time, Ali was up against a man called Leon Spinks. Muhammad Ali was in his later years. He was almost in his late 30s. He was up against a young boxer, a young challenger, Leon Spinks. And nobody gave him any chance, not even an outside chance, that Muhammad Ali is going to be finished, because he's totally out of form. He's totally out of practice. Everything against him is against Muhammad Ali. Madison Square Gardens, 15 rounds. Experts, projections, predictions, prophecies, not even 3 rounds to Muhammad Ali. He will not last 3 rounds. And Madison Square Gardens, 15 rounds fight, and the fight begins. Round number one, Ali under pressure. Round number two, Ali is getting smaller. Round number three, Ali is getting clobbered badly. Round number four, and his eyes are black and blue. Round number five, knockout. And who's knocked out? The younger boxer is knocked out. The bigger boxer is knocked out. The favorite is knocked out. Leon Spinks is knocked out. Muhammad Ali is the world champion once again. He's cocking a snook at all the critics who said that Muhammad Ali is not even going to last 3 rounds. He looks at the critics and he utters his punchline, because he's giving an answer to everybody, and he says, "I am the greatest." A reporter walks up to him and he says, "Finally, we agree you're the greatest. But tell us, Muhammad Ali, this desire to be great, when was it born in you? Tell us, Muhammad Ali, tell us." That the reporter is trying to pull my leg, realized Ali, because he was a man of sharp wit. And he said, "Halt, reporter. To be great, desire alone is not enough. Along with desire, you need vision. Along with desire and vision, you also need ambition. This desire, this vision, this ambition needs to be backed up by skill. Not only skill, also will. And the will is more important than the skill, because the will works upon a desire, making it a broad-based vision. Further working upon this vision, making it a burning ambition. Only when the burning ambition is there, the fire is there in your gut, the fire is there in your belly, the fire is there in your intestine, reporter, will you ever walk the path of greatness. So don't ever say desire alone is enough to become great. Great man has given us a definition for greatness: desire, vision, ambition, backed up by skill and will. Listen. Friends, right, here we are today, as I said. This 1 hour we are going to devote to what we call as the power of the will. On the skill aspect, I am nobody to talk to any of you over here, because each one of us over here, or the ones who are going to view us, each one of us is a master in his skill, in his trade, or in his profession. I don't have any right to talk to any of you on that aspect. But yes, friends, on the will aspect, I can share things with you, because my belief is, if the powers of the will are utilized, these powers which remain unutilized within us, which remain latent within us, which remain potential within us, if these are utilized, we will become unstoppable. 2 lines come to my mind. Mere zehn mein do lines utti. Because if these powers are understood, recognized, harnessed, and utilized, the powers are unlimited. Namumkin is dunya mein kuch bhi nahi. Namumkin is dunya mein kuch bhi nahi, phir bhi log apne irade tod dete. नामुमकिन इस दुनिया में कुछ भी नहीं, फिर भी लोग अपने इरादे तोड़ देते हैं. चाहते हो अगर फौलाद की, चाहते हो अगर फौलाद की तो सितारे भी अपनी जगह छोड़ देते हैं. सो फ्रेंड्स, दिस दैट इज द पावर ऑफ द विल. हाउ डू वी यूटिलाइज दिस इज व्हाट वी आर गोइंग टू स्पेंड टाइम अपॉन. माय ओन सेल्फिश रीजन फॉर कमिंग ओवर हियर इज इफ ईच वन ऑफ अस सिटिंग ओवर हियर और व्यूइंग मी ऑन द चैनल, इफ यू रियलाइज आवर पावर्स, इफ यू यूटिलाइज देम, we move from where we are to becoming a little better than where we are. Ultimately, where does it benefit? It impacts the fortunes of the country, because a country of winners is a winning country, a country of achievers is an achieving country, a country of performers is a performing country, a country of greats undoubtedly qualifies to become a great country. So friends, let us move towards becoming great ourselves and to making our nation also great. Yes, as I said, each one of us sitting over here or watching wants to be successful or even more successful than where we are today, because mankind has been wanting to be successful from the very beginning. There were many postulates, many theories. First, people said that it is only tall people who can become successful. But all the Hitlers, all the Napoleons were very, very short. This theory was debunked. Then they said, it is only the whites or only the Caucasoids who can become successful. But that theory was debunked because we've seen colored people from all across the world who've been very, very successful. The next postulate that came into existence was that it is only males who can be successful. It is only men who can be successful. But we've seen that females have left males far behind in so many domains. They've notched up success ratios greater than male ratios in so many domains. So that postulate was also debunked. Ultimately, the realization dawned that success doesn't depend upon physicality. Success depends upon something else. That something else is what exists over here, which is the mindset. It is the mind which is all powerful. And then began what is called as study of the mind, which we all, in modern terms, in modern parlance or modern language, which we understand as neuroscience, which is the study of the mind. There were many scientists, but one man goes down in the history of neuroscience as a man who has given path-breaking results. His name was Dr. Joseph Murphy. Dr. Joseph Murphy's books are very, very famous because he was extolling or he was studying the powers of the mind. In one book which I read, and I was startled, I was gripped, in fact, I was riveted by the way he wrote the book. It was the beginning when he says that yesterday the world respects me or acknowledges Dr. Murphy as a great scientist of the mind, but he says, I go back to my childhood. Childhood, he says, my parents expired when I was very, very young. I was a small child, he says. I used to stay with my grandmother. And he says, I still remember I was maybe in grade class 7, 11 or 12 years old, staying with my grandmother. And then he says, I was in school. I was a member of the movement called as the Scout Movement. Boy Scouts, we all know. Many of us must have been. And girls guides, girl guides. So he says, I was a proud Boy Scout. And one day, I was told that tomorrow we have to attend a scouting camp. And where is the camp? The camp is around 100 kilometers from my house, and it is a 5-day camp. And he says, we were told that we have to reach the camp at 7 a.m. sharp in the morning. We have to be there, 100 kilometers away. And he says, we also were given a warning by the teacher that if by any chance anybody is late, he will not be allowed, and he or she will not be allowed into the class. No camp, no exams, and we'll repeat the class. As children, all of us have been petrified of our teachers. He says he also was. So he says, 7 o'clock to reach there, 100 kilometers. And he says he was getting ready for the camp. And then suddenly at around 11 o'clock when he was packing, he ran to his grandmother and he says, Grandmother, I forgot one thing. She says, what, child? He says, tomorrow I have to be 100 kilometers away at 7. The bus is going to come at 5. The bus is not going to come at 7 o'clock as it normally comes. 7, I have to be over there. The bus will come at 5. Grandmother, you'll have to wake me up at 4 o'clock. You don't have to wake me up at 6 o'clock as you do normally, because the bus is going to come at 5 and I have to reach over there at 7. Grandmother looked at him and she said, child, I can't promise you, because I myself get up at 6 o'clock. The first thing that I do is I wake you up. I cannot promise you. So he says, Grandmother, what should I do? You set up the alarm. Grandmother looked at him and with a touch of remorse, she said, Joseph, I'm an old lady. I don't understand these mechanical contraptions. I can't set up the alarm. Why don't you try? He was a child. He says, I didn't know how to set up the alarm. I looked at her and said, I also don't know. What should I do, grandmother? She says, there's only one way out. That way is go to the neighbors. Tell the neighbors and the neighbors will wake you up. He says, I looked around and pitch dark. Lights were off. He says, I did not have the guts, the courage, the audacity or the impunity to wake up my neighbors. He says, I looked at my grandmother sheepishly. He says, grandmother, no way out. There's only one way out, and that way is I will not sleep tonight. She looked at him and she smiled. She says, Joseph, you're a small child. You're only 11 years old. Joseph, you will fall sick if you don't sleep. You must sleep. He says, grandmother, but if I don't wake up in time, how do I reach? I reach late, no camp, no exams, and a failure. That is not possible. I will not be able to tolerate that. He said, what do I do? She says, there is one way. What way? He asked her. And she said, one way. What, grandmother? Tell the pillow. And the pillow will wake you up. He looked at her sheepishly and he said, grandmother, this is not the time for jokes. How can the pillow wake me up? She says, no, Joseph, you tell the pillow and the pillow will wake you up. She was serious. And he says, I had no other option. Marta kya na karta? He says, I looked at the pillow. Lifeless as it was, I said, wake me up at 5. He looked at the pillow. Then he looked at his grandmother. Grandmother says, no. Tell the pillow I will get up at 5. I will get up at 5. Lifeless pillow over there. She says louder, I will get up at 5. Joseph even louder, I will get up at 5. That's what about Joseph, one more time, final time, and louder this time. And he said, I will get up at 5. She says, good, now go to sleep. And he says, I was tired, I was tense. 30 seconds, I was transported to a world which was the world of sleep, a different world altogether. And he says, suddenly I awoke, my eyes were awake. How long I had slept, I was not aware. But then within 30 seconds, all the events of last night flashed past my mind and my heart started pounding. My heart started beating. My heart started thumping. My heart started palpitating because now I knew that the clock on the wall by my right side is going to tell me what my fate is today. And he says, with a thumping heart, I turned my head towards the clock. And he says, presto. It was 4:59. And he says, exactly 4:59. And he says, exactly 5 o'clock. The pillow had woken me up, perhaps. He says, I was up in time. I got ready. I took the bus. I attended the camp. Did well in the camp. Did well in my exams. Always did well in academics. I went on to become a doctor, a celebrated doctor. But one thing rankled my mind all the time, even after my studies. How could the pillow wake me up? And he says, I started delving into details. How did the pillow wake me up? And then he says, I did research and I had my answer. And my answer was, what had woken me up was not my pillow. What had woken me up was my subconscious mind. Right? So he says, yes, what woke me up was my subconscious mind. And I started delving into details of the subconscious mind. And then he says, came the startling revelation that all power, almost 88% of the power is manifested with this subconscious mind. 12% is a conscious mind, which we understand as our mind, our willpower, which we understand, our analytical power, our reasoning power, our short-term memory, all that is in the conscious mind. But a common man understands this as the complete mind. But he says 88% of the power is vested over there, here. 88% of the power is vested over here. That is the subconscious mind. And he says, I started studying. A medical doctor I was. Can I realize these powers of the subconscious mind? Because if it can wake me up, I'm sure it has got other powers also. And then began his studies and the book, one of the biggest bestsellers in the powers of the mind, the power of the subconscious mind by Dr. Joseph Murphy, was published. My own initiation into this world, friends, was when I realized a freak accident, and my very own father, my very own dad, fractured both his hip bones. A freak accident. Both hip bones fractured, and there we were, because he couldn't get up, he couldn't stand, he couldn't sit. Only had to lie down. We were in the city of Pune, in front of the most celebrated orthopedicians of Pune, orthopedic doctors. Padma Bhushan, Dr. Sancheti, Sancheti Hospital. There in front of him, and we said, sir, what is the way out? He says, surgery. Any other way out? He says, no. Sir, how long will it last? And he says, now let me tell you one thing. Normally, what I have operated up till now is one hip bone. This time it is two hip bones. And the weight of the other leg is important for the hip bone that we replace to recover and to come in place. And I haven't operated two hip bones in my life ever. So are you sure it will go well? He says, I will try my best. How long will the surgery last? It's going to last 6 hours. That's a big surgery. We were all very, very tense. Okay, sir, I asked him. After the surgery, he says, let the surgery get through because I am doing it for the first time. He showcased it across the country, outside the country, because there were so many doctors who came to observe that surgery where two hip bones were being operated simultaneously for the first time. God was good, God was kind, and the surgery went off well. The surgery went off well, we were waiting outside. Out he came, he smiled, and we thanked him, we thanked God. And then my question to him was, Dr. Sancheti, thank you so much. You've been so nice to us. You've been very, very kind to us. But now tell us, how much time will it take for my dad to walk? He looked at me and he said, 2 days, 2 weeks, 2 months, 2 years, or he might not walk at all. But I said, sir, you're one of the biggest orthopedic doctors in India and you said that the surgery is successful. Now you're saying you can't be sure. He says, yes, Mr. Puri, I can't be sure because I have done what I could do, but there is something beyond medical science also. He says the surgery has been successful, but 2 days or 2 weeks or 2 months or 2 years or might not work at all. That depends upon his willpower. He says if his willpower is strong, if there is a manifestation, it could be 2 days or 2 weeks. But if it is not, he might not walk at all for the rest of his life. That was the day when I realized that there is something, that there is some power which is beyond the realms of medical power also. And I also became a student of this great science. That is when I got introduced to the likes of great men of the ilk of Dr. Joseph Murphy. And if we are able to understand, if we are able to harness these powers, it is a big subject. But for the benefit of all of us, for our viewers, we'll try to condense it within 1 hour so that we can make the best of this capsule. Capsule, high voltage, high energy, and a high intensity capsule of the powers of the subconscious mind. If we unleash these powers, it becomes a part of our system. Because we say everything begins from the mind. The genesis of everything is where? Base. Thoughts. Thoughts translate into feelings, but thoughts and feelings are not visible. That is, below the datum level, we cannot see them. But feelings will manifest into actions. Actions are visible. When actions are repeated, they become behavior. When a behavior is repeated, it becomes a habit. And for a habit, we don't have to exert pressure, right? For brushing our teeth, we don't have to exert effort. For driving a car, we don't have to exert effort. First time in our childhood, we had to, when we brushed our teeth. When we learned driving, we had to. But after that, it becomes normal. It becomes a part of our system. It becomes a part of our DNA. Similarly, if we are able to harness this power of the subconscious mind, it will become a part of our DNA and success will come naturally to us. That is what I said. Our aim is that each one of us starts attracting success. That the way our heart beats, that the way our eyes blink, we don't have to exert pressure. Similarly, success also becomes a part of our lifestyle. Effortlessly, it comes to us. This is Dr. Kepas. And he also did a lot of research on the powers of the conscious mind as well as the subconscious mind. Another great man where he says that our analysis, our thinking, our plans, our short-term memory, everything comes in our conscious mind. But if you look at what we call as our intuitions, our spiritual connections, when we are on autopilot mode, when it comes to our long-term memories, that is all a part of our subconscious. Research was carried on and research went on. In fact, what we understand is that the mind is like an iceberg. What we see, friends, is only the tip of the iceberg. What we see, what we understand is the conscious mind. but what is there below is around 9 times. That is the subconscious mind. That is below the datum level. A lot of research was carried on, and then came another great man, Dr. Maxwell Maltz. I will share his findings with you also. The interesting part, friends, is that Dr. Maltz was a plastic surgeon. Right? He was a plastic surgeon. He used to carry out plastic surgeries. People used to come to him with deformities, that my face is deformed, my ears are deformed, or I've got obesity. Can you kindly cure? I should look better. And he used to carry out plastic surgeries. When he was carrying out plastic surgeries, he realized, he says, that I realized that people change. Not only does their physical self change, but their mental self also changes. Their approach to life also changes. Their success ratio changes. Their stamp on life also changes. So he felt very good about it. And he published a paper. And in that paper, what he said is that when I cure people of their physical defects, when I rectify their physical deformities through my plastic surgeries, actually not only their physical self, but their mental self is also becoming better. But we all know that there are critics. There are cynics in this world. Cynics are plenty. And they jumped on him. They said, Dr. Maltz, how can you say that? Are you sure? Can you support? Can you authenticate? Can you validate what you are saying, Dr. Maltz? Do you have figures? He did not have figures. He said no. He was apologetic. But then he resolved. He said, I will start keeping details. And he started keeping logs. When he kept logs of every patient, how that patient came in, what he did, and what was the impact on the patient, he realized that the result was something else. And it was not a complete change for everybody. Not everybody changed. In fact, he realized that there was a big set of people, after he was keeping records, that there were 30% for whom no change actually happened. For a lot of them, there was a lot of change after the plastic surgery. 70% after the physical deformity was changed, their mental self, their confidence, and their success ratio changed. But for 30%, there was no change at all. He started studying those 30% because he realized that he actually had been proven wrong by those 30%. He started studying them. And then came the startling conclusion. Those 30% were the people who had come to him and said that, Dr. Maltz, I've come here because my father has sent me in for this plastic surgery. You know, I know nothing is going to happen with this. Today you're going to remove this obesity from my midriff, from my belly. But tomorrow it's going to come back. So it's not going to make any difference. But nevertheless, my father wants it. So please do it. Somebody who had come to him, deformity after an accident, please set my nose right. But I know that you actually cannot set it right, because people will ultimately realize that it is deformed. There still is a scar which is visible. So I know, Dr. Maltz, that your plastic surgery has got limitations, but nevertheless, you can carry it out. So this was common in all the 30%. The commonality was that before the surgery, they had expressed doubts. They were cynical whether things will change after the surgery or no, or things will come back to where they are before the surgery. And for those people who had doubts that things will not change, things actually did not change. And for the ones who came to him, that, Dr. Maltz, I've been having a tough time. You know, there was some problem with my hormones and I put on weight. But sir, if you set me right, believe me, I'm going to answer life straight on, face on and full on. Or somebody said, it was a misfortune I had an accident. But I know, sir, that with your knife, with your scalpel, you can wield magic. Please wield the magic on me and life is going to come back full speed. Please do it. And the ones who said this, life actually changed for them. And then came the revelation by Dr. Maltz that yes, the people, those who thought that things will change for them, things actually changed. For the ones who had decided beforehand, before the surgery, things will not change, things actually did not change. Then he published his hypothesis, which also has become a world bestseller, where he says that yes, it is the power of the mind. And it is, I talk of my senior, my guru, Dr. Joseph Murphy. The subconscious mind is all powerful, said Dr. Maltz. But he says there is one more thing I want to add over here to Dr. Murphy. That this subconscious mind, which wields around 88% of our mental powers, is like a block, is like a machine to whom we can give direction. We can either project it, we can guide it, we can direct it, we can channelize it towards success, or we ourselves can direct it towards failure. Where we want to put it depends upon us. And he says that us, that is where comes into play the conscious mind. Because he says that this conscious mind has got analytical power, it has got willpower. The subconscious mind doesn't rationalize. The subconscious mind cannot think, but it has got all the power. Giving the right direction to the subconscious mind will depend upon our conscious mind. But he says, here we are, friends, this is the most important part. This is the subconscious mind. It depends upon us whether we can take it towards success or whether we can put it towards failure. And how we put it towards success or failure, over here the role is going to be played by this small power called as the conscious mind, which is we are going to apply on our subconscious mind. And this is what it terms as psycho-cybernetics. Now, psycho-cybernetics, friends, because I come from the world of engineering, and if you understand, cybernetics is the science of pre-programmed machines. A machine where the target is fixed, right, Ms. Bhagwat? Like a torpedo, where the target is fixed, right? Or like a missile, where we know which city is the target. Well, here we are, friends. This is one of our missiles. We are proud of our missiles, right? The BrahMos is one of the best in the world right now. This is, of course, Agni 3. Agni, or Prithvi, or Akash, or Trishul, or Nag, or the very pride of our country, that is BrahMos right now. We all know where the targets are. There is no dearth of enemy countries, and the targets are fixed. Similarly, our subconscious mind also, we can fix the target consciously. We can direct it towards success or towards failure. When the principles, when the basics, when the fundamentals or when the tenets of cybernetics are applied to the mind, evolved the science called as psycho-cybernetics. Psycho-cybernetics is a science by means of which we can harness, we can recognize, we can understand, we can utilize, and we can unleash the powers of the subconscious mind. But there is a role of the conscious mind also. That doesn't mean that the conscious mind or the conscious psyche doesn't have any use. Subconscious, we might want him to work on our physique, right? Our viewers could be interested in great physiques, interested in bodybuilding. Well, somebody wants arms of 18 inches or 20 inches. We could utilize our subconscious mind directed towards those results. But if we don't exercise, can we have those arms? We cannot. We would like to have 90% in our exams. We could unleash, we could utilize the powers of the subconscious mind, which could be very, very helpful. But we will have to put in our basic efforts of study. If we don't study consciously, those results will never come. So both of these are connected, interconnected, and intertwined also at the same time. I will not dwell into details, but if you look at the personality ordinates or the conscious qualities that each one of us must be careful about, they are daily, day to day, rigmarole, mundane, but many times they are overlooked. We should practice these. Based on one quality, people have gone down in history books as greats. If we consciously make a package of all these qualities, start practicing them, and then we also utilize the science of psycho-cybernetics, we actually become unstoppable. We leave our mark on life, our print on life, and our imprint on life. That is the very reason why I am over here, friends, sharing my thoughts with you. Indeed, an honor being with each one of you over here and the viewers, of course. Conviction, confidence, the great Muhammad Ali goes down in history, posterity as the greatest. Timing, the right action at the right time. Wrong action at the wrong time is disaster. Field Marshal Sam Manekshaw, architect of one of the greatest military victories in the last 500 years, the pride of India. The birth of a new country, Bangladesh, 16th of December 1971. It was a strategic strike. He was being pushed into getting into the war in July 1971 by the erstwhile Prime Minister, Mrs. Gandhi. As says his biographer in the book, Biography, Soldiering with Dignity. But the right action at the right time, and the result is history is created, geography is altered. Courage. Abraham Lincoln said, leaders have great qualities, a package of qualities, but the first quality amongst all qualities is courage. Clarity of thought, tenacity, the ability to hang on. But all of us like to sing songs, right? Even today, the best, one of the best methods of relaxation is singing. And the great man who comes to mind is Abhas Kumar Ganguly. The great man, Maverick. Who, sir? Kishore Kumar, born Abhas Kumar Ganguly, 4th of August 1929, Khandwa. Music or film industry history, Bollywood history is incomplete without him. But success was not easy. Success was not coming easily. Kept on trying, but no. Ultimately, it was the ripe age of more than 40. When in spite of all efforts, when people actually said, go back to Khandwa. And he felt he should. He did not give up. 1969, when Aradhana happened, and there was a face by the name of Rajesh Khanna. And history was created 13th of October 1987, when the great man left for his heavenly abode. But the last 18 years of the great man were the best years. Now what we are saying is tenacity, the ability to hang on, that we don't give up. Many times we give up too easily. The ability to hang on, tenacity, another great quality, which is a conscious quality that has got to be in place if the subconscious mind has got to be give results. We talk of resilience. As I said, based on one quality, people have gone down in posterity as greats. I've talked of one great. Let us talk of the other great also, the great man, Rafi Sahab, Muhammad Rafi. He ruled the industry from 1949 to 1969 in great heights. Guinness Book of World Records, maximum recordings in one day, maximum number of songs ever recorded. The man who could sing on 7 octaves, some say on the 8th octave also, that was only Rafi Saab. If God had a voice, they said it is only the voice of Rafi Saab. But then bad times can come at any time. And when this twin hurricane, Kishore Kumar, and a face called as Rajesh Khanna at that time, the great man was shaken off his pedestal. And he had a very tough time, a very depressing time. The man says in his biography, in his daughter-in-law Yasmin Rafi, the wife of his son Khalid Rafi, says that between 1969 and 1976, very, very bad days. The man who had 14 recordings in one day, for 6 months he did not have a single recording. And he felt depressed. And people were there to pull legs. People were there to call names, and then he also thought that perhaps he should retire. He should go back, but then did he give up? No. Kept on fighting. In 1974, he got a foothold. One foothold, small foothold, a young little girl. Music directors whom the great man had supported. Singing for 1 rupee because he was a great human being also. And when even all those music directors had turned their faces away from him, there was this 22-year-old girl from Gwalior by the name of Usha Khanna, who said, Rafi Saab, I have a song for you. It was a small budget movie, Havas, a small-time struggling hero called Anil Dhawan. And Rafi Saab had a face. And what a song it was, which we hum even today. An evergreen song, Teri Galiyon Mein Na Hum Rakhenge Kadam, Aaj Ke Baad. The man got a foothold, And from there he clawed his way back in 1977. He was back to where he was, whether it was the great Kavalis of Amar Akbar Anthony or Sarg or Dharamveer or Hum Kisi Se Kam Nahi. And the national award winning song, Kya Hua Tera Vada. And the great man was where to where he belonged. 31st of July 1980, he left for his heavenly abode. But he was where he belonged, that is the number one position. Photo finish it was, but he was over there. And this city, the city of Mumbai, a very busy city, people don't have time. And people were out, it was pouring cats and dogs. And people were there in huge numbers to pay the respects to this great man. So it is resilience that we don't ever give up. Passion. We talk of RQ, that is relationship quotient. First they said IQ, then EQ, but we say now it is your interpersonal skills, your relationship quotient. MQ, that is motivational quotient. And then nobody likes a dull person. A man should manifest raw energy, pure energy, complete energy, total energy, because a dull person is liked by nobody. Am I right, Ms. Puri? Right, sir. Call it energy, call it verve, call it zeal, call it zest, call it enthusiasm, call it gusto. The meaning is one, the result is only one. So all these are the conscious qualities that all of us must have, we shouldn't overlook, or we must inculcate. And then we let our subconscious work. Now let us understand what psycho-cybernetics is, or how do we use the conscious mind to unleash these powers of the subconscious mind. We call this mental metagraph mapping. Creating metagraphs in our mind. Now a mind, as we said, has got two parts, right, sir? Conscious and subconscious. Now how do we harness, or how do we create these graphs, which are actually like contours, but because we are making them in the mind, which is actually abstract, we call it a metagraph. So how do we make these metagraphs is what we are talking of. Which are the steps that we will take over here? It is a detailed science, but for the benefit of our viewers, we will compress it so that it becomes a capsule which actually can be utilized. Now the brain releases electrical energy. There have been experiments which have proved that the brain also has energy, electrical energy. There are brain waves which are released. And like all waves, like all energy waves, these also have got frequency. Now what is the frequency? There are three kinds of frequencies, there are three levels. One is the alpha level, second is the beta level, and the third is the theta level. Right now, if we have to put it very, very briefly, because each one of these slides, friends, can go into hours, but we are condensing it for our own benefit over here. Now if you understand that this stage at which all of us are talking over here, we are using our conscious minds, we are talking, we are understanding, we are analyzing, we are rationalizing, right? We also are thinking on what this, perhaps any one of you could be thinking. What is this gentleman saying? Does it actually hold water? Can I apply it, right, sir? Because the human mind has got limitless thoughts. The domain or the expanse is limitless, it can go anywhere. Now what we are doing right now is at this level, that is the beta level. Here the frequency is 12 to 40 hertz. We also have two other levels. One is called the alpha level and one is called the theta level, 4 to 8 hertz. At the theta level, our body functions become very, very slow. Our heart beating is very, very slow. They say that perhaps in a night when a man sleeps, there are 2 minutes, 3 minutes or 5 minutes when we are going into the theta level. Maybe they say sometimes 1 minute. At that 1 minute, if somebody shakes you violently or even kicks you, perhaps you will not realize what happened. That is called as the theta level. And then we look at what is the alpha level. Now the alpha level is 8 to 12 hertz. Now here this is not even beta and this is not theta. We are somewhere in between. Now when does the alpha level manifest? This will manifest when we are somewhere in between. It is an in between state. We are about to go to sleep. We know that sleep is taking over us, lying down in bed. But we haven't slept. We can hear the sounds, we can hear the voices, maybe of our family members talking outside. But we still haven't slept. We try to answer if we hear something, but we realize that we cannot answer. But we are understanding. We are comprehending what each person is saying. That is what we call as the alpha level. Second time, it happens is when we are about to get up. First stage, awake almost into sleep. And second is, we are sleeping and about to get up. The chirping of the birds is audible, but we are not awake. People around us are talking, somebody is talking, but we are not awake. That is called as the alpha state. Now, the alpha state is 8 to 12 hertz. Now, just below this, 7.3 hertz is what we call as the hypnotic stage, when a person can be hypnotized. Now, this is what we call as the most potent stage, semi-hypnotic stage. This is the time when consciously we can actually work on our subconscious mind and we can infiltrate the subconscious mind. But this has got to be done consciously, because consciously we have got power of analysis. We have got what we call as willpower. We will use this to infiltrate over here. Now the subconscious mind has got a lot of power. The power is tremendous, but the subconscious mind cannot calculate. It cannot analyze. It cannot rationalize. So this is the time when we will infiltrate the subconscious mind. This is the best time. This is the most fertile time. Now the subconscious mind, if we talked of fertility, we can draw an analogy over here. Subconscious mind is like very, very fertile soil. A soil that will give great results in the form of cultivation. But the seed that we put in this fertile soil, that will depend upon us, whether the seed is high quality or low quality. If the seed has got to be high quality, the results will be high quality. And if the seeds are not high quality, sir, even if the soil is very fertile, the results will be comparatively lower. So the seed has got to be high quality. That means consciously these are the qualities that we will work on. We will not overlook. We all know them, friends, but we tend to overlook them. As I said, based on one quality, the great names that are mentioned over here, they have written their names in the world history books. If we make a package of these qualities, that is our seed. This package of qualities we put in this fertile soil called as the subconscious mind, we become unstoppable. And that is why I have come over here, friends. I share my thoughts that each one of us leaves a mark on history, on posterity. His mark, his print, his imprint. This is the alpha stage, semi-hypnotic. This is when we will infiltrate what we call as our subconscious mind. How do we do that? Now we do that, we will actually unleash what is called as the law of attraction. What do we do in the law of attraction? The law of attraction is very simple. It says that you will start attracting from the universe what you want. The end result that we want will come. The universe will give it to us. But then there is a catch over here. There is a rider over here, friends. We will get from the universe what we give to the universe. It will come back intensified. It will come back magnified. It will come back multiplied. It will come back amplified many, many times. So what we give to the world has got to be good. It has got to be positive. And only then what we will get will be super positive. It is something like, now whatever the good great Almighty has made is all neutral, right, sir? Water is neutral. Air is neutral. We say the universe or ether also is neutral. Just like water is pH 7. 0 to 7 is acidic. 7 to 14 is alkaline. Similarly, the ether or the universe also is neutral. There are positive frequencies. There are negative frequencies in equal magnitude which are floating around. It all depends upon at what level or what frequency we take our mind to. This is a transmitter, right? We know transmitters in martial or military parlance, we say that if the transmitter frequency is cracked by the opposition, then all the secrets are out, because they have access to everything. So what matters is the frequency of the transmitter. Can we take our transmitter, that is our mind, to a frequency that is great or that is positive? If we take it to a very positive frequency, we will attract the same positive from the universe. If plus 2, we attract plus 2. It becomes plus 4. There is no dearth of plus 4 also floating around. We attract plus 4, it becomes plus 8. We then attract plus 8, it becomes plus 16. This will continue till we achieve our result. Or the other way, if it is negative, minus 2, we will attract minus 2. It will become minus 4. There is no dearth of minus 4 is also floating around, and we will attract minus 4, it will become minus 8. Till the negativity will increase to a magnitude so much that these are persons who carry negativity in their mindsets and on their tongues also. Yes, sir? Behavior also, absolutely. Jin ke baare mein kaha jata hai ki inki kali zaban hai. Galat bolte hain aur wo baat sach ho jati. That is, their transmitter is working at extremely negative frequencies. So how do we actually build up our frequency and make it positive? As I said, the time is the alpha state. We will utilize the conscious, and what will we infiltrate? Our subconscious mind. Now, each step is a very detailed step. But again, we have decided that we will make a very powerful capsule, a capsule of 1 hour, which can be practically utilized. So the first step is what? The first step is speaking to our own self. But not speaking to our own self, it is speaking to the subconscious mind. Was Dr. Joseph Murphy speaking to the pillow? No. He says, I was not speaking to my pillow, I was speaking to my subconscious mind. Well, friends, talking to our own selves, talking to our own subconscious minds, talking at the right time, talking the right thing, talking the rightly framed sentences, that has got a technical term that is called as auto-suggestion. Suggesting to our own selves, not to our own selves, it is actually suggesting to our own all-pervasive and very, very powerful subconscious mind. The power of the subconscious mind, we know, or the power of the spoken word. Our culture has believed for a long time that the spoken word has got a lot of power. We have believed this for thousands of years. Our shlokas carry a lot of power. We know the power of the most powerful word in the universe, that is the power of Om. Because that is the kind of vibrations which are emitted out of the verb, the word Om. Resonance, vibration, and ultimately impact. So, power of the spoken word is immense. What do we speak to our subconscious mind? That makes a difference. The time I have discussed, what we speak is what we are discussing now. Auto-suggestion, as we say, the subconscious mind cannot rationalize, it cannot think, it will catch anything. So if we say that I can't do something, I cannot do it. No, when we speak to the subconscious mind, we say, I will raise my capabilities. As said Dr. Murphy, I will get up at 5. I cannot afford it. No. The positive statement will be, I will buy it later. Because what the subconscious will catch it, buy and later. And if we are able to infiltrate our subconscious, work on our willpower, we will attract the result from the universe. Well, friends, as I said, I myself, being an engineering background person, I actually first was a little cynical. But then, when I had one of the biggest doctors of India telling me that I have done what I had to. Now, how much time your dad walks in depends upon his willpower. And I realized that the power of the will is tremendous. The power of the spoken word. Well, not only we, after us, the other civilizations also have spoken of it. There is John Lange theory which also says, words, whether they are our words or they are words coming from somebody else, could be anybody's words. Words have a lot of impact, right? Sometimes some words are soothing, but some words actually hit us from within. And bad words, or words that are not said in the right context, they will give rise to feelings. Sometimes they are good, sometimes they are not, right, sir? Feelings will give rise to what? Emotions. And emotions will give rise to what? That is hormones. And there are two kinds of hormones. One are positive hormones, and second are negative hormones. Positive hormones like serotonin, like oxytocin, and like dopamine, these are the hormones of happiness. These are the hormones of caring. These are the hormones of sharing. These are the hormones of giving. Philanthropists, these are positive hormones. But then, If there are negative feelings, negative emotions, there are negative hormones also. These are norepinephrine, adrenaline. There is what we call as the killer, which is cortisol, which is one of the biggest killers. These days we say the scourge of the modern world is stress. What does stress come from? Stress comes from hormones. So what we are saying is the spoken word has got a lot of power. Whether we delve into it in the form of mysticism, or what our culture has been saying, or we delve into it from the dimension, from the angle of science, even then we understand that this is actually connected to hormones. So the most important part is the first step, speaking to our mind. That is called as auto-suggestion, framing what we speak to our subconscious mind, what we tell our subconscious mind in the alpha state. What is our aim? We understand what our aim is. Decide what you want. Write down your goal. Write it down, friends. Make your goal very, very clear. Write it down and then frame an auto-suggestion based on it. Auto-suggestions are also called as affirmations. And many times we've had people that have come back to us and saying that, yes, I had a surgery and I was an athlete and the doctor said that you will run, it will take you 6 months to run. But then the surgery was done. I worked on my subconscious mind and I was telling my subconscious mind that I will run within 1 month. And I ran in 1 month. The doctor said 6 months. The doctor said 3 months. But I ran within 1 month. There was some other power which was working with me. We conduct workshops. As I said, this is a one-hour capsule that we have condensed. A workshop which is 3 days, which is 5 days, or practically we do one-day workshops. But then we've seen results, people who have come back to us. So what you talk to your subconscious mind is very, very important. Framing of the auto-suggestion is very, very important. The framing has got to be positive. As we said, we will not say that I will not fall sick, because the subconscious mind doesn't rationalize. It will pick up sick. We will say that I will always remain healthy. That is what we will write down. Or a universal auto-suggestion is health, wealth, name, fame and success follows me every day. Or we can make it more pertinent. We can write down our goal. We can have our auto-suggestion and we can work accordingly. So that is how we work. I will not fail in my business. Well, nobody wants to fail. But then the auto-suggestion could pick up the failure also, because it cannot rationalize. So we will say, what will we say? I will always succeed in my business. These affirmations, these auto-suggestions can be done in the beta state also. When we can, it can be done now. Anytime we are awake, it can be repeated 100 times, 200 times. But the best time or the most potent time is the alpha state. And if that is the time we train ourselves consciously to speak to our subconscious mind, what our aim is, that I will be a star by 2022. I will have a red Mercedes out of my house, outside my house by 2020. I will have arms of 20 inches another 1 year. That is how we actually are infiltrating our subconscious mind. So the framing of this auto-suggestion is very, very important, friends. Now again, we are infiltrating our subconscious mind, but then there is our friend, the conscious mind, which always has some amount of cynicism. It will say, come on, your arms right now are 12 inches and you're talking of arms of 20 inches in 1 year. Not possible. Go take a walk somewhere. Are you fooling yourself? Ye bhi bol sakta. Aaj to aapke ghar ke bahar Maruti bhi nahi khadi. Aap bol rahe hain 2 saal mein Mercedes hogi. Kisko bewakoof bana rahe ho yaar aap? Well, that is how the conscious mind could react. But then comes what this great man has said, George Bernard Shaw. Though we cannot go back and make a brand new start, but we can start now and we can create what a brand new ending. Right now we can start. Yes, consciously we decide. So what? So what? I will still have the Mercedes outside. I will still have arms of 20 inches. The smothering, bludgeoning, capturing, conquering, these impediments, these obstacles or these hurdles which will be put up consciously by the conscious mind is where what we call as the second state, that is reaffirmation. We frame our auto-suggestion, we take time, we write down our goal, we take time to frame our auto-suggestion. We repeat that, but when we start repeating that, mainly in the alpha state, Your conscious mind will interject. It will say that is not possible. But then you yourself have to quell it. What is called as reaffirmation. That is stage number two. Well, friends, the auto-suggestion formulation is not easy. Spend time on it because it is not easily done. Write down your goal. Write down your time limits. Think of what the impediments are. Think how you could overcome those impediments and then write it down. Frame it well. We spend a lot of time carrying out exercises, helping people, framing their auto-suggestions because this is step number one. This is stage number one. This is level number one and that is the most important level. Then comes the second one, reaffirmation. You have to fight your own conscious mind consciously. You have to train your conscious mind to do it. And then comes stage number three. As we say, take a paper, take a pen, or take a sketch pen, and you start visualizing your result. Visualizations. Very, very powerful. Visualize the end result. If this is the red open Mercedes, think about it, put up a picture, draw it with your own hands. Your drawing couldn't be good, but yet draw it. Put it up, make a big one and put it in the bedroom. When you're going to sleep, you see it. When you're about to wake up, when you wake up, that's the first thing you see. Make a small picture, put it in your pocket. A smaller one, put it on your table. On your workstation, in your office, wherever you are, it should be there with you so that it makes an imprint upon your psyche. Now, one is the human mind doesn't think in terms of words. If I say a red Mercedes, all of us will imagine a red Mercedes. I say open, all of us will imagine it is open. I say it has got the great tri-star in front of it, which is big in size, at least double the normal size. All of us will imagine it, right, sir? Nobody will think it is REDMERCEDES because the human mind thinks in pictures. So pictures are very, very important. Again, it is important to spend time what your end result is. People have come to us that my child was good. 80% was the norm. But then we decided these exams, it has got to be 91%. 91% was written on his desk, on his wall, in his bedroom, in his study room, on his table. And he says 91.1 or 90.8 was the percentage that my son was able to get. I said, there are people, athletes, who said that we won't run. The doctor has told us no. But then I imagined myself, I made a picture. The date was there and I showed myself running on this date and I ran on that date. So that is the power. It is not that the power can work in isolation, but this power will increase, it will augment, it will strengthen, it will bolster the existing powers which are there, whether they are the powers of the conscious mind, the rational mind, or even the medical mind or medical science. Visualize, friends. Spend time. Make these pictures. Draw them well. And this visualization should have all the details. If you imagine yourself as a great speaker, which is the platform, which is the place, which is the hall, put up the name of the hall, put up the color of the seats, the chairs, the podium over there, the color of clothes you're wearing, your shoes, go into details of everything that you have imagined. And it is only then when the picture is there that you will start attracting that picture from the universe. That is how your subconscious will start complementing, it will start supporting your conscious. Then this is not the last part. We say, inject, that is next. Inject emotion. How would you feel when you went around and your friends complimented you on your great, open, impressive red Mercedes? The feel, build up that feel. Let that flow of emotions be there. As I said, the hormones. Let the oxytocin flow. Let the dopamine flow. Let the serotonin also flow. The feel, if you went around and you had those arms of 18 inches, and when people, your friends looked at you with admiration, the feel that you would have got. You had decided, your auto suggestion is that I will top the university. Well, the way your parents, your friends and your relatives were reacting to you and the kind of feel that you would have got, right? Build up that feel. Let that hormones, let the emotions play, because they also will play a part in working on the universe. Because we say, when you do this, when you inject emotion, you are setting into motion another law, after the law of attraction, which we call as the law of expectancy, which says you will get what you want in life. Even above that, you will get what you expect in life, right? So law of attraction is first, and then comes the law of expectancy, right? Unleash this law also and let it work for you. And as we say, it moves this way. You feel it, you believe it, you expect it, and you achieve. Because a lot has got to be achieved. Our powers are unlimited. Our potential is unlimited. We say, what is inside, bring it outside. What is latent, let us make it blatant. What is potential, let us make that kinetic. Kyunki hai to hamare andar. And a lot has got to be done. As I said, I became a student of this great science when I was introduced by a great medical doctor, who said that beyond my science, there is something which is the science of the mind, science of power, the science of willpower, and actually the power of the conscious mind. So friends, what I would wish you is that each one of us has got this great power, and God actually had willed us that our subconscious powers were actually directed towards positivity or success. But in today's world, cynicism sets in, negativity sets in, bad experiences play on our minds since childhood, and we program it towards failure. We have to set it right. We've done very well in life, but then a lot more has got to be achieved. A lot more actually can be achieved. When I say this, we have to take the leap into the future, the flight into the future. Two lines strike me once again, friends, and a great audience in front of me too. When I say flight, the lines which come to my mind are, Zindagi ki asli udaan to abhi baki hai. Zindagi ki asli udaan to abhi baki hai. Iradon ka asli imtihan to abhi baki hai. Zindagi ki asli udaan to abhi baki hai. Iradon ka asli imtihan to abhi baki hai. Abhi to napi hai kuch do muthi zami humne. Abhi to napi hai kuch do muthi zami humne. Sara asma to abhi baki hai. Sara asma to abhi baki hai. A lot of success is awaiting us, because our potentials have still not become kinetic. We have to realize, we have to recognize, we have to understand, we have to harness, and we have to unleash the powers which are manifest within us. My selfish reason is simple. That a country of winners is a winning country. A country of achievers is an achieving country. A country of performers is a performing country. And a country of greats automatically becomes a great country. Friends, let us put our best foot forward, utilize these powers which rest within us, and take our own selves and our nation towards greatness. Thank you so much.